Hey everybody, it's Bree, Boudoir by Bree in St. Louis. I'm a boudoir photographer and I have a website with some blogs on it. And inside one of those blogs is a link to a video that is basically just like a vlog style follow along kind of thing as I was making my home studio in my basement with my husband. My intention with that video was more to just show people the kind of spaces that they could use if they chose to do their session in my home studio. Some prefer to rent like an Airbnb or a hotel suite, or you know, even do it in their own home, and that's great too. But I wanted a way to show everybody what the spaces looked like in my home that they could use, and I thought it would be fun to do like a follow along of how I made it, because the basement was like such a disgrace that it was kind of interesting to watch. A lot of my clients said that they liked that I had that on my blog because it kind of gave them a feel for me because I'm in it. It made them feel a little bit more comfortable booking with me because they kind of got to see me, and you know, you don't really get that with just looking at my about me section on my website. And that's something I didn't expect when I made the video, that that would help me in that way. I'm guessing it's just because in that video I'm like stumbling along, and it's probably really easy to look at me in that video and be like, wow, that girl's really, really not at all intimidating. I could probably do the shoot with her and feel okay. Because people liked that video, or at least maybe they didn't like the video, but they liked that they could see me and my personality in that video, I thought maybe it would be a good idea, instead of just always doing, you know, like a typical format essay kind of blog, that I could do a couple videos now and again so that people could watch and feel like they get to know me a little bit better before they actually walk through the door for their boudoir session. I'm gonna start putting them on YouTube because I just think that's easiest. Sometimes if you just upload a video to a website, somebody doesn't have the right software program and they can't play it. Today I kind of wanted to talk about what your boudoir photographer should or shouldn't edit. And just as a kind of a disclaimer, like, this is my opinion. Every boudoir photographer does something different. Everyone has a different opinion. And I don't mean to say that if you do or don't do these things that you're doing it wrong. So just to start out, it's kind of important to bring to the light that this whole thing kind of can sometimes seem hypocritical almost. There's boudoir photography, which is like traditionally for her or their fiance the morning of their wedding or something, and that is all great and wonderful, and I shoot brides all the time and I think they're so much fun. They have like a very special glow to them and I love working with them, and I don't mean to like diminish how special that is too. That's like its own thing. But I also love doing boudoir sessions in a way that's for the client herself or their self, and not just as a gift to a partner. Not that I think anything's wrong with it. I did that for my husband like twice. I think it's great. But I think it's really important for us to see ourselves in this kind of way. We're so used to seeing perfect women and people put in front of our faces of magazines. When you're just trying to buy your groceries, every time you hop on social media, there's somebody who looks like they have like no pores and no wrinkles, and we kind of start to think that maybe that's real when it's not, and they have like no body hair, no facial hair, and all these things that are completely normal and we all have. It's just a shame that we start to maybe think that those aren't normal. Even if we don't realize it, it kind of starts to make us feel like, well, I break out when my period's coming, and she never has breakouts in her photos, so like, I'm ugly. And that's just not how it is. Like, these people don't really have anything that you don't have, except for, you know, professional photographers with professional cameras and lights. Like, the only reason I look anything okay, not that I look good, but is because I have like major lights like blowing out any imperfection that I have. It is important, I think, to A, kind of remind ourselves that that's not real. It's beautiful and like there's nothing wrong with those women doing those things, but it is important for us also to B, remember that, what was point A? It's not real, and those women have so many more opportunities that the average person just does not have to get a full night's sleep so they don't, you know, look tired or have dark eyes or dark circles, because they can afford nannies to, you know, or night nurses to take care of their children, or they can afford a really healthy diet so their skin looks great, or they can afford medications, or, you know, they can afford to fix things that they don't maybe love about themselves. Like they can make their lips bigger, they can get implants, they can get Botox, all these things that like there's nothing wrong with. If you can do something to make yourself feel better, then that's your business. You should do it, you know, within reason. But we shouldn't be comparing ourselves to these things that aren't real. If you have like a best friend who has like a gorgeously tattooed like sleeve on her arm, you can look at that and be like, wow, that is so gorgeous. Like that looks so cool on her. But you wouldn't feel worse about your arm because you can understand that while it's a beautiful thing, it's not natural and she went and got that done and that's wonderful that she did that. She looks awesome. But you wouldn't compare yourself to that because you can understand that that's not real. It's not, you know, she wasn't born with that. And I wish that we were better at recognizing that with things like injections or Botox or implants or plastic surgeries, or maybe even just being better at recognizing airbrushing and Photoshop. They're great too, but they aren't better than you. We're all just kind of bags of organs trying to walk around and, you know, eat chips. My point with that though is that it feels kind of hypocritical to have a platform that says, you know, you're perfect the way you are, we should all be more accepting of ourselves and kinder to ourselves and more loving to ourselves. But come into my studio and I'll change you. When I think about how that feels hypocritical, I kind of just remind myself that like that's actually kind of the point of my job, is to show you in the context that these other celebrities or Instagram influencers or whatever all already have. You think that maybe you don't look that good because you don't have all those things attached to you. They're getting contoured. You know, getting like airbrush tans, their hair is getting done all the time. Like they probably have injections or Botox and implants and all these things, which again, there's nothing wrong with, but it's just important to maybe see yourself in that way so that you can be like, oh my God, with all those things, yeah, I look just like them. I am the same as them. There's nothing they have that I don't, except for they get these kinds of photos done all the time, every single day. The whole point is to kind of bring you in here and give you the same treatment. Once you have all those same things, like a professional photographer and lights and cameras and a fan blowing your hair and some editing, then there's nothing, you're the same. There's nothing that they have that you don't. They aren't just like magically better or more beautiful people. There's a lot going on there that you aren't seeing. I like to be able to give you the same thing so that you can be like, yeah, I'm great. I can be like that too. They are beautiful and you are beautiful. They just have a team of professionals in their pocket. Okay, this is probably turning into like a 45 minute intro, so I'm just gonna jump in. I wanted to talk about the things that I do and don't edit in your session, or something to keep in mind as you do pick your boudoir photographer, what maybe they will or won't edit, and I can't speak for everybody, obviously. Okay, so things like acne, blemishes, bruises, rashes, wrinkles, stretch marks, scars, that kind of stuff I'm gonna cover first. As far as skin blemishes, like acne, I do edit that out. By the way, as moving forward, there's always a specific context where something is not the same. So I'm talking in a more general sense. Obviously, every situation is a little bit different. Generally, acne is something that I do edit out. I think of things like, you know, texture on your skin or tiny little things like that, like maybe like a rash or something, as something that is temporary. Maybe it's a certain part of your cycle, so you're breaking out, but it's gonna be cleared up in 3 days. It's not part of you. Or you have a rash, like I get a rash when I go outside. I kind of equate that more to like just something that's passing. It isn't part of you or your journey or your story. So those are things that I get rid of. And of course, if a client asked me not to, of course I wouldn't. And I could see again, like going back to how this feels hypocritical, like those things are so normal. Since I don't consider those things part of who you are, or they're not permanent, I get rid of those. Now, that gets a little tricky with things like psoriasis or maybe eczema. I have psoriasis and it comes and it goes, and it can be irritated by things in my environment or by stress or by heat or by sunlight. I never have considered that as part of me. It's just, again, like a temporary thing that's a reaction to my environment. I put on a cream and it goes away. But a couple months ago, I had a bride reach out to me. It was from her wedding that I shot like almost a year ago. And at the time she said she was really happy with her photos and she loved them and, you know, everything was great. And then months later she texted me and she said that she'd been thinking about it and she wished I didn't get rid of her psoriasis in her wedding photos. It was, you know, kind of a long text that kind of felt like I got punched in the face because she said, you know, that I made her feel there was something wrong with her that needed edited out, or that it was so ugly that it needed edited out. Making somebody feel like that is so far the opposite of what I try to do every single day that it felt awful. So the first thing I said was that no matter what, your feelings were hurt and I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry that I hurt your feelings. And then I pointed out to her that, you know, on my website it says that I edit those things out, that I don't really consider them part of you. And I pointed out that I also didn't know that it was psoriasis. It was one of the hottest days of the year. It was July, it was an outdoor wedding. I thought it was just like a heat rash. I really didn't put much thought into it. It wasn't very severe or anything. It wasn't a severe case of psoriasis. And I have psoriasis and I didn't even recognize that it was psoriasis. I just thought that it was, you know, like a heat rash or something from stress, because as a bride, your wedding is one of the best, but also one of the most stressful days of your life. And I just didn't think anything of it. So all that just to say that if there is something that you do consider part of you that you want to keep in, just communicate with, even if I'm not your photographer, whoever you're doing your boudoir session with, just communicate. First, maybe read their website and read the pamphlets that they send you. I try to send like 4 different resources to every client just so I can kind of like make you feel as prepared as humanly possible without overwhelming you with information. Make sure you read all of that to make sure that maybe you don't miss something that says like, hey, I get rid of things like this. And if you don't want them gone, you can just communicate with that photographer. And I bet almost every photographer in the world would just be like, yeah, sure, no problem. I never ever would want to make somebody feel bad about themselves, or especially not my clients. That's kind of like the antithesis of what I stand for. Things like freckles or scars or stretch marks, I try not to touch. A lot of times those things do tell stories of things that you've been through or things that you've beaten. And those are things that I wouldn't, unless asked, you know, by the client, I would never on purpose try to get rid of. Maybe your stretch marks are from having your babies, you know, that's not something that needs to be erased. And the reason I said I try not to mess with those things earlier is because sometimes things just kind of happen and it's not intentional. I use a lot of really bright lights in my photos. Unfortunately, sometimes those bright lights kind of wash out things like freckles. Also, things like stretch marks sometimes are so faint and so light that when I do kind of, you know, go over everybody's skin or airbrush them, the contrast fades of the stretch marks and they kind of look, you know, very much faded or hardly even noticeable if they weren't really significant stretch marks, you know, to begin with. Next would be the way that our skin kind of naturally folds in on itself when we bend a certain way or if we're hunched a certain way. When I was first starting out, I did get rid of those things and I really wish that I didn't. I very quickly realized that like that wasn't really something that I should be doing. In my mind back then, I was thinking, well, I'm not messing with their weight or their size or anything. I'm not like pushing things in or flattening their stomachs or anything like that. I was just getting rid of the actual presence of, you know, the actual lines that were created when somebody folds or bends. I don't go back and look at those photos because I wish I didn't do it, and it's kind of like cringy for me to look at them, but I bet they look really unnatural. And I try to be more careful of the way I pose people and make sure that everything is nice and elongated and stretched. I try not to squish anybody down anymore. That was when I was kind of first starting out and I still had a lot to learn. What I do edit out is if your body is being manipulated by something that has nothing to do with you. If I'm posing with my arm, you know, out or out away from me, my arm looks like my arm, but as soon as you mash it against your body, if you're posing, like maybe if I have the client do something like this, everybody's arm is smushed and the fat or the muscle is displaced and it looks way bigger than it actually ever is. I would just kind of pull down just a little bit in the editing, just so that it looks like your arm again. It's your body being manipulated by being pushed up against something else. Another perfect example is like stockings or garter belts. I think they are so much fun to use in a boudoir session. I love them. However, there is some editing that I do. Your thigh is being manipulated by an object that you have nothing to do with. I'll just show you an example. I have stockings down here. Okay, I had to go put shorts on so I could show you. This is the weirdest thing I've ever done in my life. This all gets just like pushed out. If there's like a really noticeable flyaway hair or something, or I'll brighten somebody's eyes. I will lighten teeth, maybe like just two shades. But I never go so far overboard so as to like change the smile or make it not recognizable. So for body hair, things get a little bit trickier because very similarly to what I said with stretch marks about how if I buff someone's skin, sometimes the contrast of those stretch marks is so diminished that they are like hardly noticeable anymore. Body hair is tricky because I would never want to, like, it's just like, again, like that's so normal. Like everybody has hair all over and it's weird that we pretend that we don't, but whatever. If I'm like buffing somebody's arm or something, their hair might not be as visible. And that's not me intentionally trying to get rid of it. I can use myself as the perfect example. I have naturally jet black hair and like the whitest skin. I could shave and step out of the shower and still see like my hair through my skin. And I know it sounds crazy, but I bet there are people out there who know exactly what I'm talking about. If I can tell that you on your own choose to shave your legs and I can still see what I'm talking about that I see in myself, I will get rid of that or, you know, buff it down. If there was a woman who made the choice not to shave, I would never go in and change that. Things like sunburns or tan lines, I do my best to make less noticeable. I try to use my best judgment based on the context of that situation, that shoot, that day, that client, her needs, their preferences. But this has been kind of a good general description of what I go into a shoot editing session thinking that I will or won't edit. I try not to change anything that I think does a disservice to the client. I, as a client, would want a polished product. Otherwise, they're just kind of nice photos. But if you're going in for like a professional session, this is what I would want, so this is what I do. If you have any other questions, though, about what I will or won't edit that are a little bit more specific to you, reach out. I'd be happy to help. I'm always happy to help. Whether you're doing a session with me or you haven't booked a session with anybody yet, but you are looking to book one, I think that's awesome. I'm really excited for you. It's just like the best. I love being a boudoir photographer. Okay, so if you've made it to the end of this video, thank you for sticking by me as I stumbled through every point I tried to make. I will try to get better at this. And thank you so much. See you guys later.